Welcome back to the European LCS. You can see the Unicorns of Love doing a fan meet with the guys outside. But now we have two other new rosters of Vitality and Rocket about to go at it in our final match of the day. Very interesting and very cool to see all the ambiance here in the studio as well. Let's start by taking a look at the two squads with Vitality on the blue side of the rift with Cabo Shard, Shook, NukeDuck, Yarnen, Kasing, and Shanz. Of course, Vitality buying the LCS spot from Gambit Gaming and doing some very interesting things. We dropped the name of Super Team already. I don't want to jinx anything, but this is a very good looking lineup in terms of individual skill.
Oh, it really is. I mean, if there's one team that I would say has the highest skill cap when it comes to the newer form teams, this is it. Like, Vitality are a mechanical, just almost mechanical gods team. That's probably too far for that, but Shook is a player who mechanically is a jungler, is very strong when he's on form. Cabo Shard, everybody talks about how mechanically good he is. So on a European level, this is like the team that if they get high skill cap champions that have a lot of potential on their lineup,
there's a lot of skill
they
can
do well. That's what I'm saying, is that's the downside. Can they do that every single time they load up onto the Rift? I probably wouldn't say every single time. They need to do it at least against Fnatic, Origin, and H2K.
I would say Shook, his performance last split, obviously very difficult for him coming in, and the team was already losing to Copenhagen Wolves and so on. But Shook still managed to have some good early games. And again, it's what we know from Shook, but it's always also been the issue for Shook, is that we get the great early game, the perfect game versus Najin White Shield for Alliance at Worlds, and we're like, holy moly, this guy. I mean, that is insane. And then the next two games, we don't even see him load onto the Rift. And we're just like, what's going on here? Find that stability for Shook. Combine it with Cabo Shard. That 2v2 is what I'm looking at for Vitality, because I know Yarnen and Kasing will do fine in the 2v2. I know NukeDuck will be good in the 1v1. I need to see Cabo Shard and Shook get synergy, Fnatic summer style-ish with Huni Reignover. Then Vitality can really get rolling.
And super interesting, you mentioned it as well, keeping that bottom lane together. Of course, we didn't see Yarnen and Kasing in H2K, but Vitality, that's a very good move, in essence, keeping those two together.
It isn't, you know, it nearly didn't happen. We saw Kasing go over, play a little bit for TSM.
Yes, and just a little.
Comes baiting. Yeah.
But he comes back, you know, they were pretty vocal. They wanted to play together as well. So, I mean, it's a good building block to start with. When you look at a team like Vitality, who as an organization are new to League of Legends, new to the LCS, you pick up two players like that that have got experience playing in the top three of Europe time and time again. I think that's a great starting point.
Yeah, and I think really that bottom lane combined with NukeDuck is going to be the backbone for this lineup, because again, we are expecting Shook and Cabo Shard to kind of go a little bit up and down from time to time, because it is fairly all in the way they like to play. So they need that backbone. Again, I like to look at this lineup and kind of look at Fnatic of last year in terms of how I expect the playstyle to be. I'm not saying in terms of overall leveling, but like the playstyle, because you got Cabo Shard, who is a bit of a Huni type, carry, split pusher, so on. Mid lane, you have the Febiven type in NukeDuck, who can play both assassins and control mages, who, in my opinion, are consistently just a very stable laner. And then you got that team fighting AD carry in Yarnen, you got the shot calling support in Kasing, who can also roam quite a lot. Shook is the only one who doesn't really fit 100% into this one. He is the question mark in that sense. But I think this lineup will play with Shook around Cabo Shard and the 2v2 lane of Yarnen and Kasing making work on their own down the bottom lane.
In any case, a very, very strong roster put together. If we look at the other side of the Rift, let's take a look at the lineup for Rocket, because a lot more questions there. Freddy122, Airwags, Betsy, Safir, Edward, and the coach I'm So Fresh. They lost nearly all of their star players. All of them, actually. And if we talk, or if we look at upgrades in any role, where do you see them, if at all?
Well, I mean, it's insane how different of an offseason it is for Vitality and then for Rocket. Again, as you said, losing basically the core players of Rocket, NukeDuck, Jankos, and Vander. I don't think there specifically is an upgrade on this lineup. Top lane with Freddy, if he can have a comeback year, basically a season 4 performance, maybe, but honestly, I don't see an upgrade.
Well, we do have 5 minutes left before we get into picks and bans, so let's talk a little bit more. Maybe start with Freddy. He had openly come out last year and said, well, you know, this wasn't my year anymore. There needs to be a new chapter. And now he finds himself on this Rocket roster, so what can happen?
Well, he was very, very honest in the offseason, in the AMA that Rocket did on Reddit, just talking about the problems SK had, why he didn't feel like it suited him as a player anymore, that, you know, moving forward, he really wanted to get back to his top form. So the one thing we do know is if Freddy is on his top form. He has previously been one of those top laners that everybody talks about for Europe.
Yes.
The problem is that was such a long time ago now.
And Freddy was not the guy who said, where's my team? Okay, get on my back and I'm just going to go forward and I will literally be the big carry. He was always the team player. He's always been very good in terms of communication, in terms of teleports. You know, he plays a lot of different picks up there. He has a lot of tanks, obviously, in his champion pool. And he fits very nicely with a team who has strong carries. That is sadly not the case for Rocket. When we look at Betsy and Saphir, formerly known as Jeepers, obviously, who went over and tried to play
and
with Renegades.
And Edward. And then goes to Pepper. And then Edward.
Yeah, now it's Eddie. Oh, Edward again. We call him Eddie. I need someone like Betsy or Saphir to step up and show that they are better than people expect them to be in order for Rocket to become more than a team fighting just to avoid relegation.
I wonder, though, if that's too much to ask for, which seems very harsh. But I think Betsy, when you look at it, he had a couple of weeks right when he joined Gambit, when he came in for Nick, that he actually looked pretty solid. That's why they stuck with him. He looked like he was at a level that was the mid laner that Gambit needed at the time. The problem was, over time, it just became apparent that the rest of the mid lane scene in Europe just kind of outgrew where Betsy
yes.
was. And he just stayed at the same level. And right now, it's not the kind of level that you'd expect from a middle of the pack team.
Betsy also joined Gambit at a point where Europe wasn't the strongest region, where we were still kind of rebuilding.
And we are now? What are you saying?
No. But Europe right now is a lot stronger than it was back in spring last year. That's a very, very big difference, because we had to rebuild every single team. And even like Fnatic and SK and so on, they were still trying to figure out how to play and everything back then. So Betsy joined at a point where I didn't feel like the greatest competition were there necessarily for him. And yes, he looked fine, and he definitely did. Summer, we didn't see too much from him. That was really where the other mid laners, as you said, got better and better, and he kind of stood still. Airwax, though, is a guy I want to look at in the jungle. I think he's kind of my wild card as a guy I look at on this lineup, who has shown the ability in the past to honestly have fantastic early games, where he gets every single lane going, he ganks everything left and right. It didn't happen often enough, but I think Airwax has the skill to be a great jungler. I'm not sure the rest of the Rocket, though, can enable him.
We're still waiting for a mouse issue to get fixed on stage before we get into picks and bans. One of the two things you really need, of course, to get into this game.
I hear that's helpful. But speaking of one of the newer additions to this lineup here for Rocket, Saphir, formerly known as Jeebus. When you look at his performance in Challenger, in the European Challenger Series, I think it was Summer Split at the beginning, he played on Gamers 2 at the time, now G2. So he was good for European Challenger at the point. And then when the changes happened to G2, he went over to North America and just didn't have a lot of success. There was a lot of discussion around Jeebus. In Challenger, good, maybe great. LCS is a different ballgame. We've already seen some of the new Challenger players, like Senkux and Cobby from Splice, just fall in the last game against some of the more longer-standing players. So, again, it's going to be on Jeebus now to take that next step. The same with Betsy. Use the offseason. Take the next step up to a European level for the LCS. You cannot stay at a bottom of the table or Challenger level and expect to stay in the LCS.
Yeah, but you say you have to make the step up now. If we talk about people like Betsy, that was 2 years in the making. Airwax, that was an entire season almost. So you got to question if the seed to grow is there. And if it's not, how do you make it happen with this team? And how do you make it happen specifically in game one here versus Vitality with all those seemingly very gifted players?
So I don't think you look at game one if you are Rocket and say, it's Vitality we have to beat, obviously. I don't think you look at Fnatic or Origin or H2K. I think you honestly say these games, it's just like learning. We don't really care about winning those games necessarily. We are looking at all the matches against the new Challenger teams coming up, against Elements, against Giants, because those are the games for Rocket to win if they want to sneak into playoffs, if they want to avoid relegation. And honestly, for them, they're not the only team who has to kind of rebuild again with a lot of new players. So I don't feel like they are in a worse situation than anyone else. It's honestly about like all these teams like Elements and Rocket and Giants and whatever, like who matches first and who can find that strategy that works, or who can find these champion picks that make it work for these guys. Because every LCS player have one or two champions at least where they can play on a very high level. That's guaranteed. You got to find these champions, figure out how can we use them in compositions, because I don't think you need to go out and start playing six different champions each.
I would agree with that. And honestly, I think there's a key thing when you look at the mix of experience and newer players on this lineup. I think if the legacy players of Freddy, Gosu, Pepper are hungry, if they're hungry to really do well this split, this is where they need to lead a player like Sophia. Lead him into how to take that next step, because they clearly have taken those steps in the past. Mm-hmm. They have been there, they've done that, they've been to Worlds. Now you need to kind of rekindle that fire, regroup as a team and really break things down and give it pretty much everything when it comes to strategy, your picks and bans, everything about the game. Make sure that you're absolutely on top form.
And you do not have to play like SKT. A lot of LCS teams want to be SKT. I probably want to be SKT.
Hey, you do.
Why not? Let me be Faker, please.
World champion.
But you do not have to play perfect League of Legends to play well, to win games. There are very, very simple strategies in many ways that people can use and learn. Like, first of all, perfect the Western lane swap. It's something almost any team in the LCS managed to do last year in summer. You need to do that as well, so you're not losing game in lane swap like we saw Giants do, fall super far behind because of a mistake in that swap. Remove that part at least. Understand how to play 1-2 compositions. So like we have a siege composition as an example. Know when is your power spike on this one at like say 15 minutes. How do you group? When do you push? Where do you deep ward to avoid getting flanked? And then take maybe a comp where a skirmish combo, whatever. You play like Ahri, you play Lee's, and you try and pick off targets, and then 1-3-1 after. That's what you're looking for. You do not need to play five different comps. You don't need to be Faker. You don't need to be SKT to avoid relegation in the EU-LCS.
And that's what HUK did earlier today. They didn't do anything particularly flashy or anything too complicated. They were like, okay, well, we've played like 15 games together. They're going to lane swap on us. Let's just play a lane swap. And let's just win the game from that. Giants never really contested against that. If a team like Rocket can perfect that early game and that setup, there is a chance still for them.
Yeah, winning games in the EU-LCS 101. We get to talk about this a bit because the mouse issue on stage is not yet solved. It will be soon, I do hope. That gives us a little more time to talk about the Vitality roster. Talking about high expectations, we talk about Rocket and finding ways to make it easier for themselves to win the game. I feel like Vitality is a team that will want to come out and make take a stand, rather, in the very first game and dominate their opponents.
For sure. Also, after they saw Fnatic, I guess, surprise people a bit in game one, beating Origin. Now, H2K had an expected game against Giants, taking that win. So Vitality is the team we also look at and say, these guys should be top four.
Yeah.
Anything else would be disappointing. For them, though, because I think it's a little bit more raw with all this different talent they're picking together, I think it could take longer for them to really start performing well, especially on a macro level, compared to H2K, where they had two former members, and then Jankos and Vando, who had played together for multiple years now, and you put them together. So I do expect Vitality to take a little bit longer to become a strong macro team, but I think we're going to see these games where laning phase, after like 10, 15 minutes, they are just like 2, 3K gold ahead because they've just been playing so well in the lane, and they just start rolling over you. I mean, these games will happen for Vitality.
Yeah, they absolutely will. And, I was maybe a little bit enthusiastic about Vitality earlier. I think I was running before I could walk
on
that one. And I look at this lineup and I'm like, okay, I think they're actually pretty strong. But they do have their drawbacks. And one of them that I'm looking at is a player that everybody's spoken so much about, and that's Nuketech in the mid lane. He's so good in the mid lane, Never was consistently showing up for Rocket. He'd go for like 3 or 4 games and be like, on form, that's Nuketech, we're seeing him, he's brilliant, he's amazing, great, Nuketech from scrims. Then he'd have 4 games where it's like, okay, Nuketech's not exactly showing up, whether it's his team, whether it's, the setup point. This time around, Hyunin and Kasing in the bottom lane, good setup bot lane. Cabochard, you'd assume, will win most top lanes. Good setup there. If Shook can get him snowballing mid lane, could have a more consistent...
Wait. I do think that the Fischer wants to challenge the Nuketech point.
Okay.
I think Nuketech on Rocket, if you look back at the summer split, take the recent split, only struggled in the games where the rest of the Rocket lineup didn't have anyone drawing pressure.
Right.
So it's like, oh, Steve is playing a tank. Okay, fair enough. Or Mr. Riles is playing a farm lane. Oh, fair enough. Well, who do we target? Nuketech in the mid lane.
And this is the difference. This lineup is the difference.
Because Nuketech, in the end for Rocket, look at, when he played the Gauntlet.
Yep.
When he played the last few weeks of the LCS, I felt like he had great games. He played Varus, Victim, whatever. He had fantastic carry games. Azir was awesome. Now, as you mentioned, the pressure is not on Nuketech. it will be Karpashad and Shook together. You have to respect that.
Yep.
Yanen and Kasing, when they played on H2K, were super aggressive as well in the way that they like to play the lane.
I'm going to cut you off right there because we are into picks and bans, so let's get it over to our casters. Woohoo!
Woo!
We're here. Thank you, Shox, and thank you for sticking with us. I know that was an extremely long break, and we were just chilling out here. But we
Paul's had to do his hair.
Yes, I did. So did you. You even asked me
I
how yours
asked
was
for a
looking
double check right here.
Yeah.
So there was actually no mouse issue. We just had some issues with Paul's hair.
Yeah, both of us. We had to get that synergy online, but we are literally just seconds away from getting into Champ Select. Or not. We are actually just going to wait.
We don't know.
More seconds.
We saw them hop into Champ Select. We were all giddy and excited.
Got baited.
And they left Champ Select. So right now, we are looking at a lobby with six players in it.
We are Crepo.
Who's your favorite player, Pulse?
Ooh, that's a difficult one. I'm interested in the Vitality lineup, and specifically Shook, because all of this lineup is very consistent looking. You have a lot of synergy already there, like Hyanan, like Kasing. And then Shook, for me, is like the wild card. Like, what can he do in this lineup? Because if he shows up, then you have an extremely strong team.
Yeah, if Shook can win the... Or if the teammates can win the respect of Shook, I think, and which they can, because they're all mechanically gifted players. Shook as a person seems to respond very well to very mechanically proficient players, and I think in Nukeduck, in Kasing, in Karpashad, even Hjarn, he has that, so he should be able to fit well in that Vitality lineup, especially with some of the coaching staff that they've gathered for themselves. I think Shook should be able to grow into a strong jungle discipline.
Yeah, I think so too. And also looking at the bot lane, we already just mentioned it, the synergy between Hyanan and Kasing have been together for a long time and specifically wanted to carry on playing with each other. We've seen how strong Kasing is by himself as well when we even saw him in like All-Stars, for example. Even when you just paired him with the likes of Huni, even though they played Lee Sin and had that city tandem mode game, it was still amazing to see the synergy he can build with another player. And the fact that he decided to stay with Hyanan says
a lot. Yeah, says a lot, because Kasing had a wealth of offers overall here. Coming into the split, he even had a short stint there on TSM, but he did choose to go back with Hjarnan into this new lineup with an incredibly high skill ceiling overall. Maybe the first week it won't work that well because of the macro play might not just be there yet, but we've seen from a lot of teams so far, they just carried over what worked in summer and did it quicker. Kasing should be able to do that same. But in terms of raw talent, the ceiling is just so high for Vitality.
Yeah, and that's exactly what they were saying on the analyst desk as well. But hopping over to the side of Rocket, this is a completely untried and untested lineup, like we were saying at the very start of the day. These are all new players to this team and playing with each other.
Yeah, Rocket came out as an organization saying that they signed back, I believe it was, their mid laner. So they signed Nukeduck, Jankos, and Vander. That's a statement they made open in the public. None of them are there anymore. Right now, this lineup, without sounding too harsh, it seems like when you open the fridge when you're hungry and there's nothing to eat, so you close it again and you go in with lower expectations, that's kind of the roster they drafted together. All players that kind of have to prove them themselves again. They can, potentially, but a lot of question marks on the side of Rocket.
Oh yeah, a lot of question marks. But we are finally into Champion Select, so let's take a look at some of these champions that are being banned out. Kindred, still remaining 100% ban rate, so is Gangplank. Fiora also being banned away here, along with Tahm Kench and Lissandra.
Teams ready to go in. Blue Lumei may well be the last ban. We'll see. Potentially first pick here for Vitality.
Yeah, Lulu has been banned in every single game so far. So has been residing on the bench. But Olaf will be the final ban. So Lulu is going to remain up. Olaf, we saw Gamsu go ham earlier in the day. And see what that pick can do. Going to keep them away from Karpashad.
So likely now Karpashad and Nukeduck are arguing. You play Lulu? I don't want to play that. That's boring. I want to carry. So
Nukeduck,
we may actually not
don't
see
mention
it.
Me, man. All right.
Don't make a sound.
Yeah. Yeah, Nukeduck probably not going to want to play Lulu in this game. But what do they have in terms of priority? Lulu would be the obvious one.
It would be, but you may just have two players here that don't want to play that champion and want to play something else.
Yeah.
See how much the coach can
go and shook him. I'm sure it's viable in jungle. Yeah, there we go.
Has to be locked in pretty much.
Yeah, has to go in. And they can decide where it goes later because it is a fantastic flex.
Yeah. We usually see like Lucian Poppy come out here as a response, Poppy being the blocker to Kalista, blocker to the Corki, and then the Lucian being the strongest AD carry. That is something we could see come out. Maybe Edward hasn't put in much time on the Poppy though, then it's likely that we may even see a Trundle being picked up early for a flex.
Yeah, Trundle's still open. We've seen how strong Trundle is right now. Fantastic into the many tanks that are being played on top lane as well as jungle. Still away all those resistances and just really, really annoying. In general, a fantastic pillar placement can also turn the tide of a fight.
Yeah, suits Freddy's playstyle too. We are on 6.1 though, so the pillar is slightly more expensive mana cost-wise. So you may run out of mana, but different approach here overall from the Rocket team.
Yeah, picking up the Corki here for AD carry. Again, it could be mid lane. We've seen it before. Rek'Sai coming in probably will be in that jungle role. I still want to see some mad plays coming in from Corki using the package. We didn't really see too much from him.
I love the package, dude.
Yeah, it really throws me off with like timers as well, because it's just like, you know, it's gone level 6, and it's just like, oh, Corki's back in my lane.
Yeah, once people are used to the new Corki, which these LCS pro players may very well be, it kind of loses some of its efficiency. We saw earlier in Giants, the second package gets picked up. Bing, 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 get the hell out of there, because if you're not used to it, Corki bases, you expect him to be back in roughly like, what, 40 seconds? He's back in 20, storming into your lane, killing you. So definitely shifts the time windows.
Yeah, and honestly, like, the damage you get as well is absurd. It's just like an equalizer. I mean, yes, you have to jump into the enemy team, but then you get the Valkyrie anyway. So still very strong. Looking at the next two pickups coming in from Vitality, instantly locked in here will be Elise and Thresh. So not too much has changed there down in the support role. At least not going to be seeing Poppy from this team.
Yep.
But Elise, once again, remaining strong in the jungle.
Thresh being picked up here. Peculiar, I think they... Is this the first Thresh we've seen today?
May very well be,
because we've seen so much Trundle. Trundle and Poppy both have been 100% pick banned so far, and likely one of them will fall through the gaps right now.
Yeah, we saw it in Elements G2. Yeah, Elements picked that one up, so we have seen it.
We haven't really seen it then.
No. Very true. So looking at the Rocket lineup now, 20 seconds remaining. This team's actually taking a lot of time to think about their picks as we get into this champion select. Hovering over the Taric, I've been seeing some epic top Taric cheese recently, Crepo.
Parmesan.
Yeah.
Edward has played Taric on multiple instances in both solo queue and I believe even competitive LCS, so...
Oh.
Really?
Yes, yeah. Boys. All right, so Taric has been locked in along with the Ryze, but you're more boring than Taric. Let's take a look at this champion. Could be in support, like you mentioned. It was actually picked into Kalista, if memory serves, because you just point and click, and it's like, you can hop away if you want, but I'm still going to stun you.
Yeah, definitely. Taric, usually more of a 4 out of 10, maybe 6 out of 10 with Ryze.
So perfect.
Overall, but I don't know, man. Convince me, Edward. Changed my opinion, or Freddy, whoever plays the champion, but in the competitive landscape where there's so many supports viable right now, Taric was not one of them that I was expecting to be played here.
No. Again, could be that top lane cheese, but I'll get into that if that actually happens. And then just waiting on the final two pickups, which will be AD carry, and could be mid lane, could be anywhere actually, because Lulu is still on the board as the flex from Vitality.
Yeah, you're waiting to open that dark corner of your mind where you're stashed away the Taric
my
cheese.
Palace, yeah.
Don't let me go there. Tristana and Kennen locked in here. So Tristana AD carry, fresh support, really strong lane overall. Lulu either top mid with the Kennen. Vitality risky though. If they fall behind with this lineup, no tanks, really squishy. They can get snowballed upon, especially if that Taric gets ahead and picks a target.
Yeah, especially if you hit the Dazzle, on which is the stun, onto Kennen. Like, he has to either go into his Zhonya's or make a decision. And that's actually really annoying. For Kennen, because he has to go in, or depending on how he plays, can sit defensive on the Tristana, but we'll see how it goes. As you mentioned, very reliant on doing well and not falling behind with this composition. One more pick remaining for the Rocket lineup. What's it gonna be? Is this a sign of things to come here, Crepo? Hype intensifies.
I'm doing my Sona cosplay, just staying mute for a while. I'm out of answers here.
Oh, I'm so ready. 3 seconds remaining. No. Okay, so it's going to be the Zac lock-in. Seeing Zac coming back into the meta right now, that doesn't mean that Taric is not going to be top yet.
Well, it's likely going to be Zac top, no? Rek'Sai jungle?
Either way, it's going to be good.
Anyway, it's going to be some Parmesan sprinkled on this champ select overall. The cheese coming out from Freddy. Zac top, haven't seen. Zac really strong in the jungle right now. I'm a big fan of Zac jungle because with limited vision, he can create some really unique gank paths that are almost not counterable. Top lane, we'll see a lot of roams, maybe Freddy push out top or abandon top and go mid. But yeah, interesting to say the least from this new Rocket.
Yeah, Freddy was very vocal about wanting to change things up and, you know, how he didn't really feel he was doing that well on previous teams. And he's definitely changing up now with Zac top, so we'll see how this works into Kennen as well. We'll have to break that down in a little bit, but I think it'll be quite difficult to do.
Yeah, very magic heavy damage composition, the only really pure physical damage dealer on the side of Rocket is the Rek'Sai, since Corki is pretty much mixed 50-50. Maybe they just want to set up for a siege? Not really. Ryze doesn't really fit into that. Some zone from the Zac leap, poke from Corki, but then you walk into wave clear from Lulu, so that's not really going to work. I'll just let the game explain this one.
Yeah, it's very much the pick and mix composition here, Crepo. But make sure to join the discussion over on Twitter using those hashtags, hashtag VITWin and hashtag RocketWin, as we will be getting into this game, the final game of the day to open up the LCS.
So yeah, this will be the third time we see the Taric here in recent games. Looking over the screen, here we are. There we are again. Edward played it twice in summer. He's playing it again right now. Looking to boost those Taric stats up a little bit. Interesting.
Interesting.
With exhaust, though.
What interesting is this pause?
A real man would have gone ignite, but Edward opted for the exhaust.
Yeah, so playing more defensive. I mean, it kind of makes sense here. Want to get time for the Ryze to scale up. I don't really know where the power spikes are going to come in for the Zac. It seems like more of like a mid-game pick, but just depends on how Frey builds as well, if he's going to go full AP and be super toxic.
Zac's just a very big nuisance, really, in a late game. His mid-game, his damage spike is definitely in a mid-game when he relies a lot on the base damages and a little bit of the magic penetration he gets. I've seen Zac tops get an early haunting guys with sword magic pen shoes to really get snowball. If not, they can just go tanky and just be incredibly annoying. So Zac has the opportunity here to really cancel out Cabochard's effect in team fights. He can mess with Yharnam too. There is a lot of cancel though. If they have plenty of vision or even blue trinkets to scout out where the Zac is leaping from, a Flay interrupts it, a Hex can interrupt it, Wild Growth can interrupt the leap. You have Hjarna's ultimate that can interrupt the leap, so you have plenty of counterplay on the side of Vitality to deal with that Zac. But when everybody's looking at the Zac, that's maybe when Betsy wants to strike and start hard carrying these teamfights on the Ryze.
Yeah, quick update. Betsy does have some resolution problems with his PC, so just getting that fixed up, and hopefully we can get that going very shortly. But yeah, jumping back into the picks as well, Kennen being picked up back top as well. You can see him going for Doran's Blade, which is very standard just for the auto-attack, harass, and lane.
We saw it from Atom earlier, but it didn't really work out, mostly due to the lane swap. His teleports were, yes, they were good, and yes, they forced some summoners, but with Kennen, when you're behind, you need to force some kills, because otherwise the teleport is wasted. It's a pretty much of a shotgun pick in the mid lane. You need to really, one blast, one TP, one chance. If you take it, it's good. If you let it slip, not so much. But Cabochard, he could actually bully that lane. Has to be rough for Zac. I don't really know the way how Zac's ever going to win that lane. Maybe just through sustaining, through the auto-attack harass, picking up the blobs over and over, because Cabochard should never really get jumped on, and when he does, he can insta-proc the stun and walk away.
Yeah, but in the top lane at the same time, it's going to be hard to kill the Zac because of his passive, and he just sits underneath turret, and you can't really finish him off. Smite is kind of good if they get in that situation, plus Elise can die fairly easily.
Yeah, and he has to be careful too, because Kennen usually as a pick is very hard to gank. A lot of people avoid the Kennen because of the Lightning Rush, he can avoid the ganks. But if you look at the gap close potential between Airwalks with his tunnels and then Flash and Burrow, combined with Zac Leap, Cabochard will have to play safely at a reasonable distance.
Okay, we should be unpausing here very soon, but I also want to jump back onto the Taric pickup, because that's a very interesting one coming in here. Picked into the Tristana. I'm just wondering, is there a theory that you click Dazzle before she rocket jumps, or what is the idea here? Well, either way, we are getting into game once again, finally. Hopefully no more pauses.
So, for people that haven't played much Taric, his stun duration, as a crouch chance. just gonna leave some moment there. His stun duration used to scale depending on the travel time of the Dazzle, no longer does. It's only the damage that varies, so it's always the same amount of stun. Usually, you can buffer out of the Dazzle with Tristana's jump, so I don't think it doesn't cancel it at all, so Hjarnam should be safe. It just sets up for a very easy Q from Corki in the lane though. That it does, so it facilitates poke. It's locked down. You can Dazzle into Snare from Betsy, or Dazzle into a Tunnel from Airwax, Dazzle into a setup from Freddy, so a lot of dazzling plays can be made. But generally, when you walk up to use that spell, you can also just get popped immediately.
Yeah, and instantly that ward cleared away, so kind of will be losing that one. But yeah, again, with Taric, if he gets on top of you, Kappa, he will be able to do a lot of damage. Actually does way more than you really think he will with ultimate and shatter. It's actually a lot of burst. So combined with Corki, yes, there's a lot of magic damage, but the fact he's got Shred on top of Saphir's Shred, it's just Shred on top of Shred.
Yeah, but once that ultimate comes online, Hjarnam obviously has self-peel available with his own ultimate, and Kassim can always flay and box. So that's the problem with Taric. He's very, very easily kited, and he only has one CC. He does stun that Krug incredibly well. Right now, Nuketuk and Betsy fighting in mid lane. So we see a lane swap being initiated here by Rocket. Roaming he does well, though. If he can show up in a lane and dazzle, he generally pulls him well.
Yeah, likewise with Zac as well. A lot of roaming potential. I think Kissing just stole that as well, so that might upset some of the experience that Airwax is going to get here. Freddy, I believe, got some as well, so that was okay. And they will go to the second cap. So not too much disruption from Kissing there.
Yep, we need to see how Vitality's jungle pathing gets affected here. So they take two camps while initiating a lane swap. That's very good, honestly, from Rocket. So Vitality wasn't really ready for that lane swap. A lot of camps available right now. Whereas if you look at the other side, only Wolves went down. So there's a camp advantage for Vitality, but they can't, for Rocket rather, but they can't really use it too much in a double jungling sense because of the experience changes. You really want your jungler to be solo jungling to get the maximum benefit of those camps.
Well, looks like we're going to get that fast push down in the bottom lane. Cabochard will be joining Hyana and Kasing to take this one down. Second minion wave is coming in. Should arrive before that one dies, so they should be able to keep up the damage. And yeah, Tristan's also got E as well, so should be able to keep that down fairly quickly.
Whereas in the old lane swap meta, you were fine with potentially sending your top laner back to double jungler. I think right now you always want to bounce the wave to your top laner to keep him in the game.
Yeah, and that seems what they're doing right here. Bottom lane is dying way faster, but also drawing Airwax up there. So it's going to be a four-man push coming in from Rakka versus the three down in bottom lane. Chuck is actually just picking the skull very early on into this game. These towers should be falling at around the same time. And mid lane doesn't really do anything in lane swap, so just chilling.
I mean, it's good for Ryze. Free farming, he gets to rest a little bit. But obviously, when both junglers reveal themselves, it's a lot easier to farm. Shook hasn't revealed himself, so maybe Betsy has to be a little careful. He's pushing up. He has the cleanse available to dodge out of the cocoon, though. Hopefully Vitality has spotted that, so they don't set up any crazy flashes to chase after him.
Yep, tower's dropping, and did you see? I think Freddy just there got all of the gold just from that tower. It looked like everyone backed off from Rocket, so just helping him a little more there. And additionally, the wave is in the right place. That should push towards him. Yeah, that wave is set up.
Lars, he can get some experience. He's soaking a little bit, not pushing the wave back before basing though, so he still stays there on level 2. Gonna keep track of the experience. Freddy is about 2.5. Cabochard is already level 3 right now, so experience advantage for Cabochard. He did it slightly different, whereas usually you get the wave bounced to you and you freeze it. The evolution of that was actually just into pushing it out because people will react to your freeze and outplaying that way. So Cabochard, small experience lead, and he bases again, and he goes to the top to do the standard lane swap meta right now where both towers on the side fall.
Yeah, already specking into magic resist as well. Looking at the team of Rocket, you mentioned the champion slayer Crepo, so much magic damage on this team. Picking up an early Negatron just to start getting that up will help him a bunch. Hyana and Kasing now pushing in this top turret with Shook and Cabochard in tow. But Airwax is coming up, so it will be a 3v4 if we get into this fight. AoE damage coming in from an explosive charge on the tower, and now the push comes in. A little bit of wave clear from Sophia, but Edward doesn't really do much to in this situation. Airwax doesn't really clear either.
Yeah, but there's no dive here coming out ever from Vitality because obviously Freddy still has teleport available. He is now pushing out the bot lane, so Rocket with a good three-man defend on what traditionally used to be an extra tower swap here. They're adapting here, doing a three-man defend in phase two of the lane swap, and that gets Freddy ahead. Cabochard will likely teleport down to the bot lane or walk there right away right now to pick up the massive wave that Freddy's building right now. So nobody really getting punished. I still think Vitality overall will pull ahead of this lane swap, especially if you consider the time that Shook has spent alone compared to Airwax.
Looks like the latter here as Cabochard is walking down to that bottom lane, still holding onto that teleport just in case there's a cross map play. Just holding that up, and plus the wave is slowly pushing towards him, so he doesn't need to get there immediately.
Yeah, and you can see how Thunderlords really makes Lulu mid even better than it used to be. Those short EQ auto trades now actually proc Thunderlords every single time and makes it hard for Betsy to fight back.
Yeah, still farming away. They're only four CS behind his opponent, so he's not doing that badly, and the minion wave is pushing into him, so as soon as that resolves, he should be fairly even, and Betsy should get to the stage in the game he wants to be as Ryze, the machine gun caster, and then yeah, Kasing and Hyam just flipping up, so we're now in Australia land.
Yeah, we're just waiting for the junglers to make a move right now. Very, very even early game. The only thing we've seen really is pressure exchange. Initially, Betsy was pushing mid. Now Nuketuck is keeping him down by pressuring him. What can the junglers achieve with the state of these lanes? Where can they break a mold open and finally get one of their teams ahead?
Yeah, Cabochard right now, not really open to a gank. Top lane, fairly difficult to gank as well. If anything, Rocket could maybe head up there with Airwax, but still, the Rocket jump and Kasing just being able to flay back is very difficult to gank into. These lanes are fairly just stale in terms of trading and also what the junglers can do. Invade coming in here by Airwax, just getting some deep vision, that's all he can really do right now, try and track the enemy jungle with Tremor Sense and Wards.
Yeah, both these teams have an incredibly good mid game with at least one late game insurance on every team. So the late game insurance for Vitality is obviously the protected Tristana composition, having Jungle Twist for, with a lot of peel from Cabal Shard. Dazzle comes out from Edward, Hjarnan jumps out, that is textbook gameplay. Whereas Rockat, their late game insurance is just Betsy, so we need to keep him alive if you're Rockat.
Right now, Betsy is going to take this blue buff, has gone for the tier already, building towards the Catalyst, which is traditionally the core for Ryze, and is on his way towards that. Has been revealed as well as he heads back into the mid lane. Shook coming into the bottom lane now, just seeing if he can get anything off, but doesn't look to be the case.
A soul single clap, yeah. Crowd.
Well, he got the transfer we've seen before. It doesn't always go well.
Yep, they totally mechanically executed that blue buff. We've seen some failure here.
Well, Nuketok still farming, minions.
Yeah, nothing will happen here until the sidestones come out, guys. I know it's a little boring, but that's just the state of the game right now. There's very little counterplay. People are respecting the junglers. Most gankable lanes have gap closers. There's a lot of respect going on. Both of these teams are fine going into the mid game. They're playing the waiting game. So once the sidestones come out, the pink wards come out, and the red trinkets come out, that's when we can see more vision denial, and we can see some plays being made. Rockat about to be sieged on though. Vitality sent their top lane duo to the bot lane, joining Cabal Shark and this massive wave.
Yeah, so Vitality actually trying to open up a gap in the armor here. The bottom lane is being sieged in. Large caster minion wave as well. Airwax is only now arriving into the bottom lane. Good chunk onto the tower, but not going to take it down today, as Betsy is also in a good position to close in if they wanted to. Additionally, with the entire Rockat lineup being bot lane, now have to head back. Someone needs to go into the top lane from Vitality, so someone's going to recall, and maybe Hjarnan to pick up that wave.
Rockat's pulled ahead, 700 gold overall. That has to come from CS somewhere. It's a 15 CS advantage overall here on the 14.
Yeah, I wonder how much that will close when that minion wave is taken in the top. Yeah. Because that's like 3-4 minion waves there. Airwax actually coming in here, just get the steal off. Shook is taking a bunch of damage, being chased down. And Zephyr coming in with the package as well, jumping along with the Valkyrie. Jumps away to the minions, just trying to farm before he goes down. Shook will be the first blood of the game.
Yeah, special delivery into Valkyrie. Zephyr following up. Really good play here. Really good use of the package. Maybe the first early game usage of the package that we've seen that really resulted in a game-breaking or game-opening kill, because now he can capture the bottom lane. That tower is under siege, and Freddy can then pour back to the top lane. He'll need some assistance, though, because we're seeing a four-man siege being set up again by Vitality. They seem to really like strength in numbers for those sieges.
Yeah, bot lane should be going down here, so small advantage over to Rockat additionally with that kill. And see if they can push that into anything else, but it's really interesting because Nuketok was also talking about this lineup from Rockat and saying that he actually thinks this lineup is much better than people are really giving them credit for, because even we were looking at this lineup and saying, well, are they the losers of the offseason? Looking at Vitality, looking at H2K, how many good members they picked up. So far, Rockat actually in the lead in this game.
You could have argued whether it was worth for the sync to flash play there, but they obviously didn't know what the backup was that was coming, and their goal was a tower, so Freddy essentially just wasted his teleport.
He is here for the farm, however, but this is pushing away from him, Edward there as well. And now we should see Vitality backing off. Chuck is just in the river, still farming away. He has gone for the Balmy Cinder, though. Just looking for the Cinderhawk build. Before we saw Elise pick up the Rylai's as well. So we'll see if Chuck does something similar. Edward now heading down this river. And see if he rushes Sightstones as well. Pastor, when should you rush Sightstone, Prepper?
Always.
Always.
In loving memory.
So we see Airwax now coming onto this crab. See if they go for the first dragon as well. Players are typically seeing the first dragon as one of the bigger objectives to take, and then after that, it's very difficult to go for a 5-dragon win.
Yep.
The first one is important because of the percent damage you get from it, but then the rest don't do a whole lot for you.
Yeah,
it's there as an exit objective.
If you can pick it up along the way, you can go for second dragon, and then the third has some value in terms of moving speed, but honestly, dragon has very low priority. The only value is maybe denying your opponent to get his first. Once both teams sit on a first dragon already, there's no value in playing on the dragon. You may as well start sieging. Vision is even more important, or just setting up phase two, like setting phase one of a two-step play, more important than getting dragon right now.
Yeah, for sure. Sophia down here, in terms of vision, they were cutting off just from Edward maybe coming in from the side. And Airwax was thinking of going into the bot lane, but actually doesn't do that. Vitality ahead, 60 to 40%. Still, not as big a disparity as I was actually thinking coming into this matchup.
Yeah, but looking at the way Rockat's taking this game, Vitality seem to be trying to force a lot of moves. Like, they're constantly grouping and sieging, but Rockat is fine, comfortably sitting back and actually getting a gold lead by not breaking where the pressure is being placed by Vitality. And overall, 2,000 gold ahead right now, even with the first blood. First blood only amounts to maybe 600 gold if you take kill and assist in. So, ironically here, or unexpected rather, the better macro gameplay from Rocket.
Yeah, and that's the interesting thing. It's macro gameplay. There's been no real like skirmishes and who edged ahead in terms of mechanics. It's literally just been on the macro game, and Rocket's the one coming out ahead with these players.
And the first Moby boots I think we've seen today on support. Kasing not opting for the Boots of Swiftness. So he will go down to Boots 1 speed in combat.
Yeah, decides not to get Swifty in this one. Kasing coming into the mid lane with Nuke Duck. And just farming away. And I really think he just hit the nail on the head. Both of these teams are licking to get into the mid game here, Crepo. Along with Ryze as well, just want to scale up. And as a result, they're quite happy to farm away. And you can see that resulting in the farm in the mid lane. Nuke Duck literally has hit basically every minion, 127 right now to Betsy's 120. Yep. They've done nothing but farm.
They're playing PvE right now, obviously into the Ryze's favor. I mean, getting a little quicker into the mid game is nice, but Rocket right now hitting a Triforce spike already on Sphere. He's pushing, and it becomes a game of minion wave control right now, because all the rotations that you could potentially set up for yourself to get a side lane tower and then force people to make mistakes, you can't do because the side lane towers are gone. So it's very weird to play such an early open map. You almost have to go back to the stages of the 4v0 double tower lane swap meta back in, I believe, last year in spring, before we even see such a big map right now. And because you have so little wards, it's so hard to really get the vision game going. So Vitality struggling a little bit in this new meta.
Well, from all the gold and all the farming that's been happening, it means they're getting to item spikes a little bit faster. The Abyssal Scepter has been picked up, that hook going just wide of Edward.
Maybe it's just the zone from Taric. Maybe that's just it. That's the answer.
Yeah, the threat alone from Taric engaging on you, man. Vitality just don't want to go for the play. And in top lane, don't get that tower either. Reminder, the package is available for Saphir if he wants to make another play. The first one went actually very well. Take a look at this as well. Herald now being picked up. Don't see that every single game. It's more of an exit objective like Dragon right now. It's like if you take an objective, you can go for Herald, or you get a kill, you can go for Herald if you just have spare time.
In an open split push scenario, it's good to do, because the minions, obviously, they gain more attack speed overall. They look like they get buffed like the Baron buff, but remember, the magic resistance doesn't go up, so using Herald to siege down mid doesn't work, because magic-based wave clearers will still shred them apart.
Yeah, attack speed increased by 40%, but no resistances. Additionally, it does give you 10% extra damage. So for a split pusher, it's actually pretty sick, because you can go for those 1v1s and know that you're probably going to win, even in matchups that typically don't win. But in this game, this is going to be buffing a couple minions.
Let's see, Saphir, is he going to pick up the package? That's the one question we're asking ourselves here.
Yeah.
Observers, to the base.
Track Saphir.
Yep.
Oh,
there we go.
We're off into the top lane.
Choo-choo. I love the fact that you can package and then Valkyrie again. A lot of people forget that, even though Valkyrie is horribly short right now. Many people fail even wall jumps because it's a 600 range, I believe, it's reduced to Saphir in the top lane. It actually allows him to push on the tier 2 tower safely, because nobody can stop him. He can choo-choo out of there and get back to the top side of the map. He's basing right now, puts it a big wave in the top lane. That means if somebody from Vitality responds, the rest of the map gets played 5v4. Siege in the bot lane here. We may see a big fight here with the package, with the Zac lead. Keep your eyes on it.
Well, Betsy coming in, Kabashaw taking a lot of chunk damage. He doesn't have Zonis just yet, but Hanan is there to fight him. Alex coming over the wall, has been hooked in by Kasing, joins the rest of his team, but he's getting chunked down by Betsy. And Airwag picks up the kill there. Nuke Duck now having to back off into the river, and it's now Vitality on the run. Two kills go down.
Another setup siege from Vitality, where they group up with four or five members to take a tower, thwarted by Rocket. They saw it coming. Saphir based immediately, get a good two-man package right here. Betsy flying from the side, he took out Kabashard. I believe his cleanse was prematurely. This is why he did not get out of the cannon stunlock. But overall, another kill, another dragon here for Rocket. Another red buff steal, and maybe even the mid lane tower. Rocket playing fantastic.
Yeah, and Betsy's found Nuke Duck in the middle lane as well. Will flash away, but gets him with a final overload. Saphir just chiming in there with a couple autos. Betsy's looking down basically by himself, sitting happily on his Rod of Ages. 1-0 over to Betsy.
Jesus. Rocket, surprising many people, including myself. I would regret that comment I made in the opening of the game. It's karma.
It is.
It's the second time it happened.
Gonna take a look at that team fight again though, and Kabashaw getting completely picked out by Betsy.
Yeah, Cabochard here stuns. Betsy, yeah, cleanse didn't really affect that much. Maybe it wasn't. No, it wasn't already in cooldown. Look at the damage from the package here. Shook's burning. Sing gets out. Airworks flashes after him. Two kills, I believe, in total. So two kills, a dragon, a mid tower, another kill in the mid lane, making it three. So overall, Rocket, yeah, getting farther ahead.
Yeah, Cabochard. I'm just kind of wandering around, just losing ground all over the board. If you take a look at the vision controls by Rocket, starting to push into the jungle with Vitality as well.
Should have known though. I trash talked Edward once, this back in Season 2 before LCS even existed. And I got my my behind handed to me, completely got smashed. Did it again now in the pregame.
It's a curse, man.
Happened again, TLDR. Shut up, Cripple.
Well, you can take a look at the coaches there. Just taking a look at this game, analyzing it from backstage. And this is very much a macro-based game. Like, there's a couple team fights that have happened, but it's all really been about the map movements, about what the players are deciding to do on the board, and how they're reacting to the opposing team.
And every single kill has originated from the new Corki package. Yeah, can't forget that. An invade, Aerox finds Shook, Smite steals, that should have just been a steal, but because of the amazing gap close potential that the new Corki Valkyrie, or the buff Valkyrie, gives you, they got a kill right down in the bottom. The package combined with Zac, two major leaps there. Set up for Sonic kills. Now, can Rocket expand on this? Because Rocket as an organization, obviously, there's no players remaining and the coaching staff has not entirely changed, so the point doesn't really hold. But we've seen them get ahead, but then do absolutely nothing in the mid game. Have they learned how to snowball their lead, which is very important in this meta game? Because today we've seen incredibly short games, 26, 25, 24 minutes with the use of Baron. Can Rocket do the same?
Have to see in this game, and we were talking about Zac. I'm gonna hold that thought for a second. So there's a seed coming to this mid lane from Vitality, sitting on the equal towers as well. So gonna try and take an extra edge here. But talking about the Zac in Champions League, we were like, this is gonna be some quality Gouda. But honestly, in this game, he's not building super randomly, picking up AP. He's just going tank.
Yeah.
So they're adding an extra tank into the line.
He's basically a threat that can always dive in your backline, and he can even do it in full vision. You saw right there, Vitality sieging. Freddy just crouches down, starts pulling his arms back, like, I'm gonna jump, just walk away. And the siege just breaks right there, so if he can start flanking later on, he can wreak havoc, so Singh will have to flay the Zac. If you don't flay or Buster Shot top lane Zac, you will have a whole lot of trouble.
Yep, so Infinity Edge picked up by Hyannon as well, taking a look at opposing Icy Gold. Sephir just going for the Trinity Force, fairly standard. Top lane, just going for that Sunfire cape as well, just carry on pushing.
Yeah, Sunfire for push, and then pure magic resistance, which means he's aiming to jump on Hyarn. If he's jumping on Hyarn, Hyarn can't deal damage to him. Everybody else will try and get him off Hyarn. That means magic resistance to Lore, he will not die.
Bot lane, Airwax is actually sieging in here. We'll be backing away. And Edward also pushing up, trying to secure that vision. And just overall, Vitality are losing a lot of ground. You can even see some red wards right in the base gate, of the upper base gate from Vitality. They're just getting pushed back all over the board. It just starts getting a little harder for Rocket as they start pushing up because the response time from Vitality is easier from lane to lane.
Yep.
But Rocket right now, just in a good shape, chipping away at these turrets in each lane.
Rocket doesn't have to do anything right now. All they have to do is set up the vision just like they're doing, waiting for Vitality to make a mistake. Later on, they can transition into a Baron, clean the vision there, or get another package for a really quick rotation between lanes. And more importantly, their late game security blanket, the Ryze, is 1-0-0, higher farm overall, whereas Hyarnen, the late game for Vitality, is only sitting on an eye edge so far. So Rocket very comfortable. The threat alone from a potential dive here from the Taric, man, the zone, makes open another tower.
Yeah, I really want to see what happens if we do get into a team fight though, because Vitality are specifically itemizing to stop the damage coming in from Rocket being heavily AP based. We're now seeing that with the Aegis being picked up, mid lane even with the Athenes as the mana option, and Rocket just building more and more damage. So when we actually get into these team fights, which is actually going to prevail, Rocket with slightly more gold, you would think in theory, should be able to win out on top in terms of itemization, how the fight's going.
So yeah, right now we see they cleared all the enemy jungle, they cleared their own jungle. Sephir is in base. Oh yeah, there he goes, package.
Oh.
I believe, I'm pretty sure he does a global emote and reveals him for a fraction of a second. So Vitality should be aware that more damage is coming their way.
Yeah, map-wide Siren. And now coming in to the upper river.
Yeah, and the level 9 trinkets right now, sweepers.
Oh, we're ready. Saphir knocking Kasing back. He has to flash away immediately. A Valkyrie back to his own team, but a flash and a knock onto three players.
The Dazzle
coming in from Vitality. The Dazzle coming in from Edward. And Freddy is here with a lockup as well. Airwork's trying to get once again another knockup, doesn't quite find it, but everyone is chunked in from Vitality. And Rocket is going to be able to set up a siege. Nice thing, Lando post.
Casting is hard, man. I know. Just don't read Twitter. overall, they're moving back into the Baron area, but there's too many wards still about, and obviously the 20 minutes free home guards you get can actually be very, very nasty if Cabochar can land that teleport. Freddy going back to the mid lane. First package that doesn't result in a kill. A little deep from Saphir. I have to admire his boldness, but a little bit over the top.
Oof, a lot of damage coming in from the poke there, but Saphir does not go down just yet. Zero depths in this game so far. Previously named Jeebus, showed a lot up in the Challenger series, but has picked up the Rapid Fire Cannon on top of his Triforce. So he's sitting on that two item spike. Freddy looking for this gank in the backside, but Kasing locks him up, and Hyana will have to jump away. Freddy gets on top of him with the Let's Bounce, but takes the Lantern to safety. No one will be dropping in this trade.
Questionable use of Freddy's E there. Like, do you really want to jump into the enemy team when you're already behind them? Is it not wiser to save it? Kasing, really good hook though. Cancels the E, then plays him backwards. Lantern goes on Kjarnan, so Vitality escaping. Gold lead is still 5,000 for Rocket here, and they can soon start looking at their third dragon of the game. No, first dragon, actually. Second.
Counting.
Counting
hard.
Is hard. I thought they had two already.
Yeah. What comes after one? But yeah, Freddy, kind of a weird choice there. Decides to actually charge up the Elastic Sync Shot and say, hey guys, I'm immobile. Just hook me, and then gets hooked. When he could have just sat there, used Let's Bounce, and then dodged the hook perhaps, but either way, still pushed Vitality back, got a couple summoners, but it's still only a small summoner lead. Actually, not even a lead for Rocket, because they utilized a lot to get these plays to happen, so now the ball is kind of in Vitality's court.
Yeah, what worries me more is that Rocket is seemingly making plays without a goal. Usually you make a play with an objective in mind, and they're not really setting up the vision for the Baron. Because with their composition, they can make picks into face checks. If you face check into a Zac Taric, you can, it can cost you the game. But the vision isn't being set up around the Baron. They wasted their teleport prematurely. They're not really split pushing, so they're actually allowing Vitality to get back into the game.
Yeah, and as you were saying on the analyst desk as well, Rocket doesn't need to do crazy things. They don't need to be SKT. They can go with the simple strategies and execute it well. Even talking about the lane swaps, which we saw here, and executed it fairly well. However, you don't need to go too simple, because we saw that in the EUCS Grand Finals, where Malz and Dignitas, all they did was go for Dragon for the entire game. However, in this game, Dragon might actually not be too bad for Rocket to do.
Maybe they take that approach and they're like, we don't have to be SKT, we can just be KT. And if you've been watching LCK, KT is still playing that same five dragon style, very slow game, and they eventually forced it that way. Maybe Rocket has a preferential gameplay of going for five dragons. Who knows? You see if they can finally break open the mold here, clean that vision. They have one upgraded red sweeper on Airwax. Edward has not upgraded his sweeper yet, the level 9 version. Maybe he forgot. Maybe he just leveled up. Maybe it's Maybelline.
Maybe it is Crepo. Maybe a kill is in our future as well. That's what I'm looking forward to. Saphir and Betsy just chilling, just going into mid lane. Warded up. Pretty much everyone can see each other on the map right now, so the teams have pretty educated decisions on where they want to move next.
Now there's also a... Hang on, the same rule on Saphir here. Knock you out. If you don't want to sweep the wards, you can also just prevent people from walking back into the area for 2 minutes 30 seconds, and that also just takes care of most wards already because they just fade. That seems to be the approach Rocket are taking here. Split push, Airwax in the bottom. Cabochar can't hold him away. Freddy in the top lane, jumps on Kjarnan.
It's actually a lot of damage. Remember, he's building full tanks, so he's not going to get the burst off, but they found him once again, and the Dazzle Man locks him down and secures yet another kill for Rocket. Oh, Edward being pulled in, but it's Airwax, who is just in the base of Vitality, dueling Cabochar. Kasing and Kjarnan have been pushed back here, and now the top tower will go down to Rocket.
Yeah, and this was the result of the vision around Baron fading, Vitality trying to get in there, get more wards, and Rocket, yeah, they were lost in rotation. They catch him right there. Now they can default backwards to the Baron buff, or to the Baron to get that buff. Airwax can come over with his ultimate if he just finds a tunnel. Bottom right, there's a tunnel available for him. Are they doing Baron without the jungler?
Maybe. Edward just recalling there.
You're actually doing...
Wow. We've seen this in Challenger Series before. Actually, we had a jungler who would build a Black Cleaver and just split push all day. I believe it was Dan. But Edward coming in here. There's the Dazzle. Chasing him down, but the teleport now coming in as well by Cabochon. Doesn't have the extra movements before. Flash into the enemy team, and Freddy taking a bunch of damage, but he still has his passive. Airwax has been locked up, but he's away as well. And Rockhat get out unscathed with the Baron. Oh, Sophia now heading back to base. Everyone's just going to trade in all of that gold. 5 kills in this game, but the macro game has been so incredibly good by Rockhat.
I think Nuketok used Wild Growth. That knocked, I believe it was Freddy backwards, and it put him out of range for Kasing's hook. Very, very interesting interaction. So Kasing was going for a max range hook, but Wild Growth knockback prevented that overall. So that's why Vitality didn't get a single kill. And Rockhat, 5-0 so far, pick up the Baron. Don't even need their jungler for it. Yeah, they're exceeding all expectations, including my own.
Yeah, I think a lot of people's honestly crap out. Now Sophia once again with the package. Has done really well with this, actually. Has gotten multiple summoners and set up multiple kills. Now into the game, may not want to be the only form of engage. Now they have Zac.
You just use it to rotate, man.
Yeah.
You guys, he's like, you guys walk from mid lane to top lane? Filthy casuals. Yeah. I fly
there.
They're
in 1 second, man. And it's clearing out this mid lane.
So 1-3-1 being set up. This seems to be the way to, yeah, end all games today with the Baron buff, because it's so early, it's incredibly hard to deal with the Baron buff on one lane. What about 3 at once? Freddy in the top lane, Aerox in the bottom lane, both have tools to join the fight. Either it's a tunnel or the ultimate, Freddy can walk over and leap or teleport in, and Vitality, what are they going to do against this push? Their wave clear is all magic, except Hjarnen exploding some minions, but that's not enough.
Yeah, it looks like this is going to be an exceptionally good Baron power play as they take down the middle lane, and the bottom tower is also falling to the jungle of Airwax. They're just losing ground all over the board.
We don't even have enough windows to show what's going on. We need another
second
one.
Second tip. Another one.
Another one. Hooks the cannon. Yeah, that's the only way to deal with those super cannons right now. We see Freddy moving to the mid lane. If there's no wards across the wall, the zone Zac gives you while sieging is enough. And then bot lane breaks off when they can take the inhib, rinse and repeat. The game might very well end in about 3 or 4 minutes.
Man, everything is just falling. And the bottom lane as well is just being slowly chunked away. And Vitality, if they want to stop this, they just have to hard engage. But previously, that hasn't gone very well. Airwax not even hooked in. The tunnel was just coming out there, and Kasing was not in time. Rockhat, you smart. You very smart.
Not gonna do it. No loyal, though. All their players left.
Too good, man.
But yeah, I'm getting a little worried about this cannon pick. This is the second time we've seen cannon pick today. Both in the lane swap, it might be incredibly strong later, but in the lane swap, it seems so slow and only reliant on a teleport flank, and they just seem too predictable right now. Hasn't worked out for either team that chose to use the cannon overall.
Not really. So, Shock now going for this blue buff, it's actually just resetting. Edward now coming in, and he will be threatening him. But honestly, that's Taric pick. The funny thing is, we've been talking about like the Dazzle coming in and locking people up. It's one assist in this game. What? That being said, that is 20% of the kills has happened in this game, but...
Good math.
Yeah. Thank you very much, Grappa.
I mean, it's his own, right? People are too afraid to even fight him right now. That's the Dazzle. It does set up for... Okay, all joking aside, if you land the Dazzle, it sets up for more follow-up damage, especially the artillery gun that is Betsy right now in the late game. Hjarnen struggling to finish the third item. Betsy only has 3 and has an other like NLR finished, aside from some very expensive boots. So he's just gonna wreak havoc with Airwax.
Found Hjarnen. Actually, a lot of damage coming in from Airwax. He's gone for the Mount Mortius, and that alone was enough to chunk Hjarnen out. We'll have to go back to base. Take a look at that Baron play we were talking about earlier. 2,500 actually on the side of Rockhat, so not too bad.
Yeah, 2.5k, lowest Baron power play of the day, below the summer split average, but honestly, it doesn't matter. They got an inhibitor. Probably this low because they already had so much already established on the map. And as you go deeper in the lane for the towers, they get worth less and less and less. So that explains it. They did enough, though. They broke up in one lane. They chunked another one. Setting up for a second tower here, picking up the base. No juke.
The hooks are just not connecting. But yeah, Kasing just expecting the juke. Maybe it doesn't happen, that type of stuff. But still in the bottom lane. When the jungler is dueling the top laner, have a problem.
Yup, Sphere goes mid. Betsy, you don't want to get near that. Tower drops immediately. Airwax is already on the Nexus Tower, skipping a step.
Like, Vitality, you have to do something. Otherwise, you just lose the game right here. Hyanan gets a little bit of damage onto Betsy, but that's all he can do. 10,000 gold behind right now, and Vitality needs to pull the trigger.
So Vitality is going to speed up and shield Hyanan. He has to juke the skill shots that come in, do some damage. Then Cabbage Shard has to flash ultimate and pray that Freddy somehow gets cancelled in the AoE. That's the only thing he can do. Aerox is split, but Cabbage Shard is going to deal with him. Just breaking open the base here.
Aerox doesn't actually go for the tower.
Look at top right now. Flash is the hook.
Just taking everything away. The flash comes away. That was the entire lineup of Vitality responding to the jungler split push. Sophia now just backs away with the rest of the team, taking the tower bit by bit. And Rakan are probably just going to close out the game very shortly. Sophia
probably
just
has
to go back
gold
to base fairly soon because he is out of mana. And there is no package, so he can't get in there super quickly. But the tower goes down. Aerox just took a Nexus turret.
Don't get green, right? This is the point where you can still control the game. Look at all the tunnels. And then they base. Just gonna check right now what they're sitting on. Yeah, they have about around 6,000 gold, I believe, to spend here in base. Don't really need it. Just need more mana. Sphere's out of mana. Do you have another package? Don't think one is available just yet.
Yeah, soon. Okay, just chilling the base and it's like, we'll just wait for the package for our next play. But not right now.
Styling finish?
Yeah.
Expect a backdoor, the best backdoor of all time? No.
Yeah, the fight happens in like mid lane. It's just like, I'm going out, I'm going in, man.
Just splits everybody apart, just like Moses parts the Red Sea. It's like the entire team fight breaks open. I'm going straight into the base.
Yeah. The game winning play. That's there what we want to be at. Ready for this to happen. The package is live.
This entire team comp, the zone from Dazzle, the zone from Freddy's Leap,
it's all been set up.
It's been an elaborate plan. Sophia picks up the package.
Here we go. See everyone converge on mid lane now and set this play up for Sophia.
Almost like the Mighty Ducks when they go in with a B. Do you even know that movie? Are you old enough for that movie?
No.
Okay. Jesus Christ. So the Mighty Ducks, they strike in a V formation, and then the guy from the backside, he slides in between and then just goes in a very nice montage style to finish the game. And they all cheer.
Yeah.
That is Sophia right now. He's a mighty duck.
Luckily, I do know the reference because I know Stress talks about it a lot in the office. So. Before my time, unfortunately, keep going. Going for this Baron once again.
I mean, if Gabashar can cancel Aerox and then teleport in, maybe.
Well, Hyanan, this is kind of the chance. Like, everyone is kind of stuck in this Baron pit, but Freddy going for this fight, jumps in, there's the flight, knocks him backwards. Hyanan gets deleted before the fight really begins. Cabochon in the back lines, lots of damage coming in, but it's not quite enough to finalize a kill. Finally gets the kill onto Sophia, and Edward is now dropping low, but it doesn't matter. They pick up the three kills onto Vitality. Shook now running away with his tail between his legs, but Freddy now teleporting into this base. This could be curtains for Vitality.
Yeah, good setup. Lantern gets thrown in to teleport into the back line from Cabochon Shard with the home guards, but it's too little too late. By the time he arrives, Hyanan's already down. Betsy, Freddy, Edward, and Aerox looking to finish the game. No package delivery right now because Sophia is dead.
Yeah, unfortunate, but 20 seconds remaining on Hyanan. They can't defend. Rocket closing in to close in with the win. The curtain call comes down, and Rocket bring this one home. 8-1 in kills, and the first win on the board.
Game went smoother than the celebration.
But honestly, very impressive from Rocket.
I have
Rocket,
to eat my
man.
Words, man. Oh.
I think we all do. That was really good from Rocket. They showed exceptional macro play. Yes, we hopped on about it, but we have to say it. It was just solid.
Did they, though? I'm going to go home and rewatch the early game, I feel, because I want to know exactly what happened. Because Vitality were the ones making all the plays, and Rocket, they were just absorbing it and somehow getting ahead in the gold lead. So they didn't initiate a single play. Not that it's wrong to do, like if it's the right thing to do to just stay back and abuse forced plays, but they somehow got a gold lead and then a beautiful invade from Aerox with the package. Then another really good read on what Vitality was doing, almost too obvious down there in the bottom lane at the tier 2. Good fight there, Freddy leaping in, the package coming in again. So they did seem to be on the same page overall.
Yeah, at the very least, we can say the reactive play was very good, at least in the early game. But then we did see proactive plays from them. A lot of the kills that happened, a lot of the fight setups were coming in from Sophia's package or Betsy coming in. They should just engage by himself on a recall. So they did make proactive plays.
Yeah, and playing that 1-3-1 split push with your jungle in the bottom lane right there, how beautifully as they did, is not that easy. It looks easy when it works. But anybody at any given point can get caught, and you're playing against players that are no slouch. So like you're playing against Shook, you're playing against Kasing, they can catch you. Rocket managed to stay away from that. Beautiful execution. Vitality only got one kill in this entire game, and that was in the very last fight on Saphir. So, yeah, fantastic performance.
Yeah, I think the argument can be made that maybe Vitality made it too easy for Rocket because there was not a lot of... Does it matter? A win's a win, right? But yeah, there was not a lot of proactive plays happening from Vitality. There was a lot of time where it's like towers being sieged in and Vitality actually just not doing anything, not pulling the trigger, not going for a fight. And again, the argument can be made on top of that argument that they couldn't go for those fights. But then
because of the dazzle.
Right, because of the dazzle. But maybe something's messed up before that, and that's where the teams have to dissect that and see what went wrong.
All joking aside, though, if Betsy does more damage... So if Betsy gets stronger than Hjarnen, it all becomes about who can take down the late-game carrier and the other team first, and the amount of zone with a Rek'Sai that can flash and Bauer, Freddy just standing there being menacing, having a lot of base damages plus Sunfire. It's impossible to get to Betsy, because even if you approach, you do have the zone... All joking aside, from the dazzle, so it worked out beautifully for Rocket.
Yeah, honestly, the composition grew on me as the game went on. I actually just saw...
I need to see more of it, yeah.
Yes, I need to see more of it, but I would like to see more of it. That's what I came out of this game, instead of being like, that was awful. That was actually like, yeah, I would like to see another game of that. But now let's check in at the analyst desk to close out the day.
Well, talk about a caster curse. Mechanical gods, super team, super aggressive free win.
I will hold my hands up and say, yeah, I said most of those, and I was wrong.
All of those.
So, I'll take credit for most of it. And on a serious note.
Only first game. The first game.
That is where you look at these lineups and you say, that is a massive upset for this Rocket lineup on paper when we come into this season. That is the kind of win that could, at the end of the season, be the difference between your spots going either into playoffs or into relegation. And the key thing there is that Rocket... were making plays on the map as well. So it was not just Vitality not showing up. It was, you know, both sides, you know, playing into this.
I just can't believe Tarik won again. Like, Eddie keeps picking it, and he's been winning a few games on it, and, like, it still doesn't make any sense.
I can feel your pain. I can feel your pain.
He looks a bit like
so,
you, too.
So, I mean, I think Betsy on Ryze in this game is, like, this is the first game Ryze has won today. He's lost every other game. But this is also the first game where he's laning into a fairly passive laner in Lulu. So finally, we get to see what he can do when he gets to sit there and scale up. And obviously, what Rocket did so well was they didn't try to be SKT. Because they were waiting for the plays to happen from Vitality, and they would punish him when they made a mistake. We can just pull up the first replay. It's the first spot in the jungle. And I think it is such a smart play coming in from Rocket, because what you will notice is Vitality wants to play on top side of the map right now. That means Shook has nothing to do on the bottom side because he has no protection. Rocket, they know this. They have the package from Saphir. So Eryx is saying, I'm going to invade. If I find anything, come with me and kill them. So this is set up by Rocket knowing, okay, Vitality is going to go top and start pushing. Shook should never have been there in the first place. He should follow his team to the strong side of the map. That's the misplay and that's the punish.
And I think overall, just impressive play from Rocket. They came out of the gate swinging. That was 8 minutes on the clock. The very first package that comes up is used effectively, is comboed well. You know, coming into this game, there was a lot of eyes on Shook in terms of what level of performance he was going to bring. Shook has always been an up and down player. You know, he's been involved in perfect games and he's almost been perfect gamed. So this was one of those performances where it left a lot to be desired. And I think for Vitality, it's just going back to the drawing board. They do have a lot of talent. They do have the ability to make all of these mechanical plays and all the correct things. But this was just not the game to do it. It is a long season, and now we see how they bounce back tomorrow.
Well, they're going to have to bounce back in a way. But the one thing that Rocket, again, did very well on the other side of the Rift is a very similar play to the one we saw earlier from the Unicorns of Love. I loved how they grouped and sieged and just effectively used the map to their advantage and the advantages they have. Divisio, I know there's a particular play you wanted to highlight.
Well, again, it's a play we're going to see more and more in this meta here. It is when you have these compositions with teleport on one target, and then, you know what, that's going to be the next replay. Instead, we're going to look at this, a tower push.
Yeah, this one actually was just the lane swap that we saw at the beginning. Yeah. This was actually the Tristana. I was expecting Vitality to take these turrets and then move around the map and actually use the Tristana to their advantage. They ended up falling behind, and then the first blood came out in the lower jungle. I actually feel like Vitality were at a good point from the lane swap and then just ended up getting out sieged by grouping on this Corki, as we will see in a minute.
Again, the first mistake comes when Shook is on the opposite side of the rest of his team. When you keep playing fast push, you invest everything you have onto one side of the map. You can't play fast push on all three lanes. That doesn't exist. So when your jungler is so far away from everyone else, it was easy for Rocket, simple for them to say, I will invade, you have the package, you can cover a lot of distance. If there is anyone in here, you come join me and we just kill them. And that's exactly what they did.
Oh, in that one victory coming off for Rocket, which I think made all of us kind of surprised, and especially Vitality not showing up in their first
game. Replay. Because that's the
It's awesome not coming. Play. I'm sorry.
It's not coming, guys. It's not coming.
One final note. The Taric, we can argue that to, you know, death and beyond. I also am not impressed with the Protector AD carry comp from Vitality. These players have got much better abilities in some of their other roles from the Cabochon, from the Nuke Duck. Lulu, great pick. No argument there. I just think the Protect the ADC is not something that is super exciting, is something that this team needs to rely on when you look at the depth of their players.
Technically, though, like these players, Nuke Duck has always played a lot of Lulu. We know Yana has always played a lot of hyper carries. Tristana is a comfort pick for him. So, like, technically, these players are used to playing this comp. I do have to question the Kennen blind pick. I don't think it's a very strong blind pick coming in. Lane swap was okay for him, but it always sets him behind. And Kennen, once he starts falling behind, he just has so low impact in the game. So that first teleport he has, it has to pay off. It wasn't even there. It was Kabusha recalling in his own or in the enemy jungle, and then Betsy found him and almost one-shot him, and like just fell even further behind. I think Kabusha was like level 8 when Ryze was level 11.
Yep, not the best showing for Vitality. And with that, at the end of day one, 5 teams are, of course, tied for first, with the other 5 behind by a single game, because that's how that works. Fnatic, G2, HGK, UOL, and Rocket start the season with a win. As said, disclaimer, we're going to come to some conclusions. We know that it's only the first game, but it is a good indicator.
I think it's good to get a taste of how the rest of the weeks are going to play out for at least the first portion of the season. But I think seeing Splice lose a game to UOL and looking at Vitality and just how they lost to Rocket, I think those are the two big upsets of the day. Yep. Coming into it, we'd actually anticipated that Splice could have been one of the teams challenging for the middle of the table. Deficio and I actually expected Vitality to potentially be top 4.
Oh, and
we still do.
Now,
to be
fair, it is game 1. There's a lot of games to play. But I did not expect Vitality, even on a bad day, to look like they did today. So that is a shock. Right. That's quite an awakening for me. Their floor is lower than I had even anticipated.
We can just look at how the teams lose games. I look at Splice here. And honestly, I was disappointed because I felt like there was a lot of issues just mechanically between the players. I didn't expect to be there. Koppe and Nisbet, their laning phase to play 2v2 where they got heavily under pressure by an Ezreal in the laning phase, ended up being pushed down to their own tower, so Diamond Procs can go and dive them and kill them, and that obviously then makes it even worse. Stuff like that is where you're like, oh, okay, that's a worrying trend. We need to see if it continues to be a problem. No meme, maybe a meme intended.
Yeah,
sure.
So intended.
So maybe it was intended. Who cares?
But I think one thing we got to look at is somehow Fnatic have put a lineup that beats the top contender, supposedly. Our
Nothing
team coming
changed.
Into this was supposed to be like number 1. Fnatic show up, another 2 Koreans. Let's see how we do. They get a win in the first game of this
season. And not even a win for first game of this season. Also, Fnatic Spirit in that game, one of the new additions, flying out of the gate in his European debut with a KDA of 16 and a 73% kill participation to lead the league with 28.5 fantasy points.
Do any of you have them? Do any of you have Spirit or Gamzu?
No.
Now, I'm sick to the pit of my stomach because I have Noxiac on my bench. I didn't run
Don't
yet.
Throw up on my desk.
I know. And I ran So as an Amazing, who let me down so heavily.
I ran Cabochard.
I ran Nuke Duck. So that was 0-1.
Trevor will never give you slack for that.
No.
Anyway, Spirit completely out-jungled Amazing today.
On Zac.
Like, in the early game, he had such a great performance. He was in there stealing camps. He was always there setting up ganks. He had smart, unexpected ones. Like, oh, I have no passive. I'm just going to gank mid lane anyway. That Origin never expected. And the communication from Fnatic already at this stage is like, okay, we're going to fight here in like 30 seconds. Okay, push out this lane and start roaming. Like, Noxek was running. Gamzu was running. Like, there were 4 people there
and
in like a matter of seconds.
You have to put a caveat on this fact. We know that OG's come in with a limited practice.
Yeah.
We also know they had a bad day. Like, it is quite uncharacteristic to see Amazing miss, like, every Lee Sin Q. That really does not happen very often. And today was just one of those days where it just didn't go his way. All credit to Fnatic, because they got their lead, they punished the mistakes, and they won the game very well. And another jungler that stood out for me today was Diamond Procs.
Mm-hmm.
This is a guy who we myself particular, has questioned his ability, especially throughout summer last year. He comes up today. I actually was hanging out with the UOL guys and some fans downstairs earlier, and the manager was saying to me that coming into this game, Diamond had promised a 0-4 start. He said every time he started LCS, he goes 0-4. So for UOL, they're like, this is a success.
Yeah.
We've got one win more than we expected.
But I mean, you just got to look at the state of the game, right? Is that, oh, you get Diamond procs early kills and the team can end up, you know, snowballing from that. That's exactly what Diamond wants to do. That's exactly what junglers like Spirit want to do, is get that good early start, build from it. There's no sitting back and doing nothing for like 20 minutes, which is what Vitality tried to do in that game.
Yeah.
It's all about the speed in this.
Yeah, that was the biggest takeaway maybe for me. The teams that did get ahead, they had those Baron power plays and they finished the games out so quickly.
Yeah, did we see any comebacks at all in the five games? No. They all felt like as once a team got like the first few towers down and they only lost one or two themselves, like the goalie just grew so large very quickly, you get that item advantage. And again, because the vision is so limited in many ways, you can't just sit and spam wards in your own jungle, so you quickly lose that control. And then you can't make it in place. You feel forced to just sit back and be reactive. And it becomes very difficult once you're already falling behind.
Yeah, Deficio's two big storylines today, Graves and End of the Line and wards. I mean, the number of times
and
you said that.
Both were perfect.
Of course they were, but I'm just saying. Also, I think G2. You know, crazy props to G2 for showing up. This is a team that there was eyes on, much like Splice. Now, they were against Elements, so there's an element of one of the teams who is a little bit weaker in terms of the individual skill side. So I'm excited to see how they perform tomorrow. G2, I believe, go up against Rocket, and seeing Rocket with some confidence.
Yeah,
This makes tomorrow's game a bit more interesting, because I kind of assumed it was going to be a 2-0 week for G2 and the squad.
We'll see what happens. We did get a couple of good plays, and one of our LCS big plays today we want to look at is the Gamsu outplay versus Soaz. Let's first take another look at it.
Not over yet, though, as Amazing looks to chase him down. Can the Viking get away from the Blind Monk? I don't think so. He sees him coming, and he should play! I don't believe it!
Amazing missed both his Qs. He didn't get any damage down to just auto-attacks.
Poor Amazing. He's never going to hear the end.
I'm sorry for the fans at home. We screamed so loud, we almost broke the speakers.
Volibear has no skill shots. That would have been a better pick.
Well, I think
you're
going to
get
kind of
some mad tweets, bro.
Well,
Amazing loves me. Amazing
does
loves
he?
Me. Yeah, he does.
Not anymore.
Okay. Yeah. Amazing, we have a special relationship.
Another one you find a very handsome man, or is that like everyone?
Yeah.
Anyways.
Fervor of Battle, Olaf, low HP.
Yeah.
Mr. Lee Sin, like, what do you think is going to happen?
Yeah, but a good start for Gamsu, though. Yes. Another big play I want to take a look at, guy you know very well from Challenger, is Perks predicting the Flash, who was on Ahri playing versus Mr. Riles. Let's take a look at that one as well.
They can just kind of figure out what's about to happen. And
Wow.
That was a great prediction.
So, I don't know who was on the desk with me. I think someone said...
I think it was Mitch. Yeah, I don't want to put words in his mouth.
I mean, I was kind of in the replay. So
yeah.
It was Mitch.
Yeah, that's a good point. That's a good point. But that he's, I think he did say, I don't think that was a prediction, that might have been a miss.
Well,
No. That was shot like this. You missed maybe like this. That was a clear prediction.
Or you missed really bad.
Oh, you're like shooting the wrong way, right? That was a prediction, 100%.
Nice. The problem is now, because the debate or the question has been raised, Perks can just pick the answer he wants.
Yeah.
Of course I predicted it.
Of course.
That
of
was
course.
The prediction, 100%.
I mean, either way, the timing on it to just sneak past the front minion.
Yeah.
That was a little bit of luck.
I also, even if you just step back, like that was a great play, but the rest of the game was way more impressive.
Yeah.
Like,
yeah.
There was a couple plays a little bit later on where he holds his charm, and then manages to just find a target every single time onto Sprattler, if I recall. Great performance from Perks, a dude who everybody's looking at. Now, the EU mid, is this a challenger now made LCS star in the making?
Yeah, we have a lot of those EU mids. Yeah. Well, that's it for the action here on day one, week one of the Spring Split. We'll continue tomorrow. The Giants are going to go up against the Unicorns of Love. And later on, Vitality, another big test for them as they face Fnatic and want to put the record straight. And H2K will take on Origin. What do you really want to see on day two? I mean, we got to start with Vitality Fnatic in that. That is a real test. And that's a comeback opportunity if I've ever seen it.
Third and fourth game of the day, Vitality, Fnatic, as well as H2K Origin.
Yeah.
Those are the games I want to watch, because I think H2K had a relatively easy win against Giants today. They just played the map exceptionally well, and I'd like to see how Origin bounce back. They tend to do well even after a loss, because mindset and mentality is not really a problem with such experienced players. So I can't wait to see how they handle themselves.
And I think right now this is actually the test for Vitality, as if they actually are worthy of being put in a top four bracket. Yes, we're only in week one. They will have time to grow.
Always conclusions, man.
No. What I'm saying, though, is if they can take a fight to Fnatic, we'll see that they still are at that level and that maybe today was a mistake. But if they don't, then there may be problems they have to work out in the next couple of weeks.
For sure.
They've got time. They need to just measure where they are right now.
Definitely do. They have time till tomorrow, till we make our new conclusions and things get underway on Friday. That is tomorrow at 6 p.m. Central European time, 9 a.m. Pacific. So don't you be late. And until then, we're going to go AFK on behalf of everyone here at the LCS. Thank you for joining us to start 2016 off in style. And we'll see you here for the back half of week one tomorrow.
Without further ado, it's time to load up on a Summoner's Rift and kick off the 2016 LCS season! Can the Viking get away from the Blind Monk? I don't think so. He sees him coming, and he should play! I don't believe it! Down goes the inhibitor in the bottom side as Gamsu takes it out.
Nice!
You had question marks? I don't think so! Guess what, boys? FNC is back!
I'm dead.
Obliterate elements.
That's the flank, but Adam, he's going around the backside. They may be able to catch Yankos. They do get the stun off. He's exhausted. Throws the Zhonya's. That's the start. First blood. One is fallen down. Giants are in full retreat, but they've got nowhere to go. And H2K are making a huge statement to start this one off.
By the way, Mithy apparently is a player to watch now because the camera is kind of on his face.
Neos
coming for you!
Say hi!
No, don't wave!
Steelback taking the damage, it's a double kill for the Ezreal. Nisbet's caught, Diamond Prox has enough to take him down. Triple kill for Steelback! Unicorns of Love take the first win!
Going for this fight, jumps in, there's the flank, knocks him backwards. Hyunin gets deleted before the fight really begins. Camper shot in the back line, lots of damage coming in. Curtain call comes down, and Rocket bring this one home.